Content? Yes? Okay. So this will now get passed on, to cabinet and then to council, is that right? Okay, well, let's have a look. Let's have a look.
I need to recall some of the first meeting sequences to cabinet for consideration to next step.
Get passed to cabinet and then to council. Yeah, okay, cool. Glad to see you play it, thank you. All right, okay. Thank you everyone for that. Next item is the spending freeze. So again, one of the, one of the welcome changes that have occurred since Pat became leader, actually, and also with Paul as chief executive, perhaps, as they correlate, was that when the decision was taken to implement a spending freeze, Cher very kindly phoned me to let me know that that's what was being done, why it was being done, what it was going to entail. I thought, given the time I've been told, it was an opportunity for Cher to share that with Wooden Risk. One of our key responsibilities, as we keep talking about, is, you know, to give the public reassurance or assurance that money's been spent properly and wisely. We all have arguments about it, but it's been spent properly, the controls are in place, and that it's not, you know, that, as I say, it's been spent properly with proper controls. So, given that, I thought I asked Cher, would she be prepared to update the committee? And Cher readily agreed. Well, that was a good thing to do. So, so we put that on, but given it was, we only had a day or so, we said it would be a verbal report. So, Cher, over to you.
Thank you, Chair. I was going to just highlight the reasons for the spending freeze. The Chair, I think, has highlighted that quite well. So, it's my responsibility, the whole Council's responsibility, to make sure that every pound that we spend is being spent wisely, is being spent in the right place, and we can demonstrate the most beneficial outcomes for the residents of Wirral as a result of that. Another reason really is, we'll see a report later on the agenda, is we do have a compliance issue with policies and procedures. So one of the reasons for the spending freeze really was that we were, so that I am able, with the chief exec as well, and the committee, is a wish, is to have a look and scrutinise all the expenditure that we make, and to make sure that it is within the policies and procedures that we have. Is complying with everything that we are putting in place already. So the spending freeze was imposed last Friday, which was the 15th of November. There was an email that went out to our corporate management team, which is assistant directors and heads of service level. And this level of staff really, these are budget holders, people who are accountable for spending and accountable for their financial management, both financial management and budget management. It is up to them to determine what spend is critical and vital. So what we have done is posed a freeze on all discretionary spend at the moment. And one of the reasons for this, as I mentioned before, is to make sure we're spending in the right place. But also, as a part of quarter two budget monitoring, we have got a significant overspend at quarter two, the end of September, which as yet is unmitigated. This is for a number of reasons. It's mainly as a result of increasing pressures within adults and children's social care, and also some income that is non-achievable that we're not able to achieve. So we're trying to pull back any spend that we don't think is vital or critical, really. And as I say, the corporate management team have been tasked with determining what spend is vital and what spend is critical. So an instruction went out to them on the 15th to say there is a list of exemptions, so there are specific items which are not open to the or under the realm of spending freeze. This is things like children's services expenditure, payroll expenditure, any contracts that we have that we could be under an issue legally if we don't pay them. Things like council tax, housing benefits, any sort of treasury investment activities, and any capital spend, grant spend, partnership spend, or any spend that generates a beneficial income. go through all the purchase orders that have gone through as part of, after the spending freeze, to initially to analyse every single one. This will be myself and the Chief Executive, to determine whether we think they are within the realm of spending freeze or not. This is a huge, it's a mammoth task. So we've committed to doing this initially to every single one. We can filter, obviously, with some of the on code, so we can filter out the things that are on the exemption list or the things that are capital. So we're not actually looking at every single one, but only the ones that are on the, not on the exemption list. And then following that, if I or we don't, myself and the Chief Exec, have any reason to believe that we don't think it should have been sent or a purchase order should have been submitted, then I am actually writing to everybody who has submitted the purchase order to ask them for the rationale as to why they think that expenditure is critical or vital, as we have a spending freeze on at the moment. This only covers people who have submitted purchase orders. As I said previously, when we come to a report on the agenda later, we do know that expenditure goes through without a purchase order. We'll talk about that later. I can't manage that or monitor that before we actually put a commitment to expend that money. That will be a retrospective process. So we generally make all payments within 30 days to suppliers, after within 30 days. So after 30 days following the spending freeze, there'll be another audit that takes place between myself and the Chief Exec that will look at all expenditure that's gone through without a purchase order, and we will repeat that process. So it is retrospective, but we will go to corporate management team and ask them, why do you think this item of expenditure was critical and vital when we have a salary freeze on the moment? So just in terms of what happened last Friday, we did have the first list of all purchase orders that we had. This was quite late on Friday afternoon. I have not gone through all of those yet. I have scrutinised 236 of them. It took me more or less half a day to do that, so it does take a bit of time to do this. As I said, we're committed to doing that initially. I'll just give you some stats as to what's happened out of those 236. So quite a few were on the exempt list. So we had children's purchase orders, elements of health and safety, some from capital, some from contracts, some which I deemed myself as essential spend. There was some that was related to income generation, some from schools, some from the Merseyside Pension Fund, which are exempt because they have their own budgets. Out of those 236, I actually personally queried 126, so over 53%. So I wrote to all the CMT who are responsible for these budgets, and as I said, I asked them why they think this particular element of spend is vital or critical, and I've asked them to get back to me by the end of the day today. I've had some back in already, some of those are quite reasonable expenditure. They are actually essential or vital, and that seems to be okay. But I haven't had all those, all that information back as yet, or I didn't put a match at the emails anyway. So what I wanted to do really was assure you of the process of monitoring those. If there are items of spend which we don't think fit within the spending freeze, that are not critical, not vital, then that's a conversation with the budget manager as to why they think they are taking that decision. I think initially it will be reiterating that there is a spend freeze, and if they have been told explicitly that they are not to do this. Following that, if it happens again, then we would leave it up to the corporate management team to take appropriate management action with this before we're carrying out that spend.
Okay, and a couple of things that, as I said, thank you for speaking to me about it beforehand. But for instance, when we do get onto the PMs, and I think it's fair to say this committee has taken a leading role about purchase orders and that they should be done properly, we should have control around it. I just doing some arithmetic at our briefing. If you looked at retrospective purchase orders, which means no purchase orders, that came up over the last 6 months to something like £49.6 million of expenditure. With 12,000 items. So that sort of level of uncontrolled expenditure does leave us in close. chances are not compliant to all the policies as well. So so I do think it's there's a role here for the committee to support you, Chair, and the Chief Exec in terms of the controls and board putting in place. And I'm sure we'd all agree to offer you any support that we can with the organisation and the elements within the organisation to reinforce that point. And I think I've already mentioned some time ago around POs that if there is a particular directorate, let's do a directorate level rather than a function level, but if there is a particular directorate that is consistently abusing or misusing or circumventing the controls like POs or anything else, I'm more than happy to invite them here to ask them to explain themselves about what it is about their particular function that means that the controls don't apply to them. And, you know, I will make that up. You can pass that to the senior management team if you wish. That is an invitation to anyone who is circumventing the rules to come along and explain why they think they don't apply to them. So, okay. So we'll certainly do that. Paul, do you want to say something?
Yeah, sorry. One thing I'd like to just note, which is just reminding me. So as I was going through, trawling through all the purchase orders, there were actually 15 purchase orders, which were obviously retrospective purchase orders. So the narrative was, this is an order because we've received this invoice in. So it's actually a retrospective purchase order. Where I've identified those, I have written to those, again, the corporate management team to say, this is a contravention of the policies and procedures. This is an issue with compliance. Can you please make sure that all your team are complying with purchase orders? And if they are not, so if I have calls to write to you again, I would expect you to take the appropriate action. So we're actually uncovering some of that as well at the same time, which is only a good thing.
Well, the fact it's being stopped would be a good thing. Nothing's going on. So please pass that invitation across. The other thing, and again, we're all quite experienced in what we do. So whilst I know that the council has reserves and balances to cover off overspends, we also know that has to be built back up again. So next year, when you do the budget, you will have to raise money off the council taxpayer to supplement those balances. Which again has an impact on either the level of council tax or budgets and Wirral's priorities. Okay, does anyone have any questions or comments they would like to ask? I'm seeing Phil, then I'm seeing Ian. Okay, that's, I always see you. Come, Phil.
Thank you, Chair. But each time any of us turn our council computer on, we get the screen that is for the internal consumption of staff, which has a section on the ongoing budget position 2019-20. So I'm assuming every time every member of staff turns their computer on, they can look at that section if they click onto it. So first thing is that we would hopefully sort of revise it with an update regularly to say what has been achieved. And not so much that Big Brother is watching you, but please be aware that we are studying all the spending that takes place, and that there is this list that you can click on. So I've clicked onto the document that says the guidance notes and templates, and read that one. So I appreciate that staff can look at all the guidance notes and say, what does this mean in practice?
I think we
want assurance that putting it carefully, that the staff are greeted by their managers with a purposeful conversation, that questions if things appear to be going awry or not responding to the controls you put in place.
I'll answer for sure now. It's not my job, I don't, but I will. I'm just conscious that this has happened. This happens many times, isn't it? To pull up the spectrum for ease, because we don't. control expenditure, apparently, and therefore we have to stop spending till we, till our systems catch up with how much money we've actually got. But in the past, there's been quite a big group, from what I can tell. So, however it's been done in the past, they've brought all the various offices together, all that sort of stuff, and everyone's got a good reason about why their expenditure is necessary. I actually am taking some heart from the fact it's Cher and the chief executive that are directly monitoring the behaviour of various directors, because that's what needs to be done. Sometimes we tend to be too nice around this if it's not adding to, you know, to what the council should be doing, or it's being ordered in a way that isn't right, then I'm pleased we're putting some controls to stop that. That's why you could be arguing we should always have those controls in, and we should always, you know, comply with those policies and procedures. Clearly we haven't, so I'm quite pleased those things have been put in, actually. You see, the other issue really is that if we don't make these savings, it's in section, what section is it?
1414? It's section 114.
Yeah.
It's where I have to inform the council of the council. The council is not able to set our budget.
Yeah. So there is clearly merit in making sure that every penny that is being spent, every pound is being spent now, is being spent properly and on the things that it was intended to be spent on. Ian.
Thanks, Kevin. It's quite well into what I was going to ask, generally. I think to call it a spending freeze is a bit of a misnomer, isn't it? Because clearly, what we're doing is imposing strict controls over spending. We're not stopping spending, it's some spending we're deciding rightly is not appropriate. So, my concern would be when this simple spending freeze ends, we'll be back to how it was before. So, why would we not have the controls in place? I'm not saying that you sort of 30 stories yourself from the core, but why would we not have these controls in place? The appropriate officers to be able to maintain this kind of approach to spending so that we know it's only essential and critical spending that we're paying out for. Because otherwise, if you say a spending freeze starts on last Friday, when it ends next Friday, you are just hold back, you are able to purchase order in which you want to help. So.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, the date is indefinite, so we will go on to whenever we deem it necessary to go on. That will be dependent on whether we are seeing a compliance change and a cultural change or not. Since I sent 136 emails out on Friday, already people have been coming up to me and saying, "Oh, this is really serious. Do I need to come and ask you before I send anything?" All my team know about it, I've told them. I can see already that the culture is changing. One of the other things that we've put in place, or we are putting in place, we haven't done it yet, is to reduce the number of people who have authorisation to spend as well. So we have quite a few levels of authorisation, so from director down to assistant director, head of service, and then under head of service, there's quite a few levels of budget holders and budget managers. We have got hundreds of these, really. So we're doing a piece of work to actually say, is that appropriate? And should we remove some of the spending powers and some of the spending controls and elevate it up to a higher level, to a more senior level, which I think will definitely help that as well. We will be reporting on this more often as well. So whereas previously we haven't reported in as much detail as the report that we got later on in the committee, there is a compliance report that goes, we do a piece of assurance and compliance now, that is going to SLT and will come to the committee when it's complete. We are quarterly reporting to Council Strategic Leadership Team, which is directors as well now. This is our aid, we talk about it quite often. One of the things that we did think about, which we could do, because in the past there has been a tendency to be sort of a no consequence sort of ethos, so where people have not complied, there's been no consequence of that. So we've not always in the past employed appropriate management action and all that. So we are doing a piece of work with the leadership team to say, if there is non-compliance within your staff, you need to take appropriate management action. Otherwise, if you don't, you're not doing your own operating review yourself effectively. Somebody will take appropriate management action on you. because you're not, you know, an effective leader, so you need to be doing it. So we are elevating that as well. And one of the things we did think about was, specifically the comms, so we will update the website, as Councillor Gilchrist mentioned, on a regular basis to what's happened and what we found. And we did think about as well is putting the bad news messages on there. So if there is a situation where people are disciplined or have to have verbal warnings if they are constantly not adhering to compliance, is that we will say on the intranet. As a result of the spending freeze, we are issued with 5 verbal warnings in the last month. I don't know whether that's the right thing to do or yet, but that is a clear message to people that actually, if you don't comply, there will be appropriate management action taken.
Yeah.
Can I come back on that?
Yeah, of course.
Nice chair, you answered the question about can you tell me what was the position with staff that have council credit cards? Because presumably if you're a council issued credit card, you don't need permission to just use the credit card to buy whatever you want to buy. And secondly, leading on from that last comment you made, I remember when Councillor Green was leading the council. The happy days.
Yeah. We're all spring.
It was when and we started to publish the license to council spending £500 or more every month on the council website. And what you said is there's an argument to reduce the threshold on that £500, saying that we're reporting pretty much all the spending on the council website, so the public can see what we're spending.
I'll take your first question first about council credit cards. So, as part of the compliance and assurance review that I mentioned previously, we have been undertaking a review of council credit cards. There were a number of council credit cards in operation. From my perspective, a credit card is only needed for extreme emergency purchases only. So it's if we have something like we had with the issue of Newbury a couple of years ago, and there's a situation where we need to use it in extreme emergency circumstances. So we have called the majority of those back in. I think now we are only issuing 2 credit cards. We're about to finish this review, we've not finished it yet, but there will be one to Mark Hamborn, who is Assistant Director for Emergency Duty and the team. So he's the Emergency Duty Officer, he will have one, and potentially one for the Chief Executive as well, if for any reason he's not available. So we have pulled those back, and we have got a process in place now where people spend on credit cards, they have to submit receipts, they have to be signed off and approved by the line manager. But hopefully, going forward, there won't be any need to use those. In terms of your second question, which was about
reporting of spending the £500 a month on council website.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know in terms of the administration burden as to how difficult that would be. We can, at the moment, it's automated, so we can get a download. We have to adapt quite a lot of that information. We can't write in the public domain, but I can certainly discuss that to find out whether that is something we can do. You know, we're not, in terms of openness and transparency, we would not report any of that for any specificity.
Well, how time to check. Remember the arguments about the environment. Cathy?
Yeah, sure. Very hard to hear what you said, especially when you mentioned about no consequences. I mean, I'm surprised that there are no consequences in people. Don't follow the rules, and the fact that you've got too many people with authority to write checks, because it just runs away. So clearly that's a very good idea. I mean, the number of non-purchase orders, did this all come out when I mentioned 4 associates and the fact that the PPA numbers being based and that sort of thing? So I'm glad, very disappointed in the numbers, but glad that you've got help on it now. Non-purchase orders, 9,271 for just under £29 million. I know from figures. But it works out that volume of invoices that don't appear in the wrong. That works out about 50 a day. Now I would have thought it's clearly it's not in your remit to go check any purchase order number. I mean that's you know that's the only thing you want to do. But you know it's not your pay grade, is it? But you know clearly you could spend a lot less than £28.9 million in the year to employ 2 people whose job solely was to go through PO numbers 50 a day. I could do that myself, no sweat. You can follow me. But you know, yes,
a consultant.
No, for 50 days, in his job to go through them and scrutinise them and say, no, 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 possibly get lost. There's 28.9 million, there must be a phenomenal amount of waste. I mean, we've seen it just on a couple of items on this particular agenda, on this particular audit, and this committee is going on every day, every week. Retrospective purchase orders and non-purchase orders, if you're looking at 70 a day, I think it would be reasonable if you haven't got capacity in the department to employ two people who could tackle that and, you know, save almost 49 million a year, and that's value. I'd headline that. Two people saved in the council 49 million. So, yeah, so I'm great if it's coming under control. Thanks very much for sorting out as quickly and as efficiently as you have done.
Okay. So, good stuff. I've got a sneaking suspicion it will be a little bit harder than that. What's essential audits, and that's where we need all these really high paid directors and stuff to determine what's essential audits and telling us. Any of you, I'm sure you were, it was a bit of a cry for help show, wasn't it? This thing about, do we want to couple us on is the fact that we're now taking compliance seriously, was it? So, I mean, are there any views? There were, I think Cathy said, the idea of communicating that there are consequences for non-compliance. And today, it's spending. Tomorrow, I hope, will that be health and safety? So, there's a range of things that where we need people to comply across the piece. And there is something of a, you know, about changing the culture of the organisation to make sure that is happening. But you just had a go, Cathy, so I'm going to go Phil, and then I'm looking at this side to see if anyone's got anything to say. Phil?
Well, each week, I think it's each week now, the chief executive, previous chief executive's done this paper, sent by email, called Exec View, which is a roundup of the good things that have happened, where staff have been praised, and where the authorities made strides in doing something. But Exec View, I think, also needs to report the kind of work that Chair has put in. Chair has spoken to the right thing. Last week, I had to spend hours going through this to see that it's actually working. I shouldn't have to do this. The ball's in your court. Please do what you should be doing, type message, I'm afraid. Sort of spelt out fairly bluntly. Probably Exec View might have a suitable plea from Chair on that point.
Okay. You've done a bit? No? Okay. Yeah, Cathy?
Well, I was just going to make one comment. When you were saying about consequences, and it seems that perhaps the council is a bit lax on consequences. I'm sure in the private sector, heads of the world, this is your job description, you do it or you're out and all sort of thing, three strikes and you're out. I think maybe you need to be a bit tougher and make sure that people who have responsibility and get paid for that responsibility actually carry out their duties properly and help you to do your job. As I say, doing all these emails and checking everyone properly is not your job, but thank you for doing it. But, kick somebody's ass and make them do it.
I think that's a general plan, isn't it? You want to hold those officers to account. Yeah. Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's exactly what we're doing really. And I would say it's I think that there has been areas of the council where there has been some non-compliance. It's not a hot cross all council by all means. There are some officers who are really diligent, wouldn't spend anything without going through the appropriate processes as well. And I think that in some cases, because the workforce is less now than it has been, potentially there are areas where we have suffered with lack of capacity and lots of other things ongoing, is that sometimes some of these processes might have just lapsed. So it's, I wouldn't say it's in all areas, there's purposeful reason for going outside of the processes. I think there's just been customer practice and perhaps workarounds in place, and we just need to re-emphasise that actually we need to go back to the actual policies and procedures, and the reason why we have the policies and procedures in place, and that's that's to make sure that we safeguard every pound that we spend for rural residents. Because I think what people don't sometimes realise is spending some money in one area means they haven't got money to spend elsewhere, which may be for the most important.
Thank you.
Yeah,
sorry, I interrupted. I always, I think I'll do my personal life, but what I call the cost benefit analysis. You know, what benefit will I get from the cost? And I think on this particular exercise that you've done, I think there would be very much a cost benefit to making sure that there are enough appropriate staff in a particular area to verify these invoices because of the eye-watering and the looking at the 12 million potential deficit. I'm not saying that would be all fully spent, but you know, you might easily have found 12 or 15, 20 million from there, so we'll improve it.
I think that's what the accounts receive from the people.
Yes.
Okay, Gillian. I'm right, sorry. I only saw you first, I do apologize. Stuart.
Administration of the officers through an extremely challenging financial times. If you don't do diligence exercises like this, you must keep the show going. And obviously, we can not issue the section 141 notice on not unlike Northamptonshire. So I think you know, very credit to you. Remember, the previous administration, we were spending about 17 million.
Said that I think Ian's point is absolutely sound, that we need to get away from outside of those, given all that you've said, have consequences. And also, to pass on the kind of offer that if there's any particular director that is not following this through, we'd love to see them and to hear about it. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Great. All right. Thank you for that update. Appreciate that.